evening, and welcome to this League of Women Voters Forum for the candidates in the November election for Senate District 53 and House Districts 53A and B. My name is Liz Nordling, and I will be moderating this forum tonight. As a trusted volunteer organization, the League of Women Voters does not support or oppose political parties or candidates. We sponsor forums like this one to provide voters an opportunity to hear the candidates' views about issues of interest in the upcoming election. For example, many Minnesotans may not be aware that we will be voting on a constitutional amendment this fall. Currently, the legislature sets their own salaries. The proposed amendment would set up a citizen council to determine the salary of state legislators. Information on this topic is available at the sign-in table. You can also find information online at the Secretary of State's website, www.minvotes.org. Click on What's on My Ballot, and you will find a link to the proposed amendment. Tonight's forum is being taped in its entirety, and it will be rebroadcast on Channel 18. With the order for speaking tonight will begin in alphabetical order and will be rotated randomly thereafter. Candidates' remarks are being timed to assure equality time, and questions are being collected from the audience because I have stacks of them already. Our candidates are, for Senate District 53, Susan Kent and Sharna Walgren. For House District 53A, Addie Tironi and Joanne Ward. And for House District 53B, Kelly Fenton and Alberta Gillespie. We will begin with opening statements, and we will start with Susan Kent.
Thank you. My name is Susan Kent, and it is my privilege to represent Senate District 53 in the Minnesota Senate. I want to thank, first of all, everybody for being here tonight and for engaging in this important process, and I particularly want to thank the League of Women Voters and their members for all their work in putting on an event like this. It is so important in making sure that local residents have a chance to hear from all the candidates. A little bit about myself. I live in Woodbury, and I am married to Chris. We've been married for 28 years. He's a second-generation 3Mer and mother of Andrew, who is a 10th grader at Woodbury High School. I have extensive private sector experience, having worked in marketing for a range of industries and companies, large and small, and public sector experience in, as a community advocate and volunteer. In the Senate in the past 4 years, I've had a track record of results from rolling up my sleeves and working with people to get those results. I put people ahead of partisan politics. I understand my district well, and that is very important here. And I want to work on real results and innovation for the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Next with her opening statement is Sharna Walgren.
Good evening. I'm Sharna Walgren, and I'm running for the state Senate. I've lived here all my life. I graduated from Harding High School. I have a degree in economics, and I've been a patent lawyer for 20 years, working with innovators and inventors. I'm running for office because I love to solve puzzles. It's what I do each and every day. It's what I've done for 20 years. I love it, and I'm really good at it. When I look at our government, I see big issues that are puzzles: healthcare, taxes and spending, I see big puzzles, healthcare, education, taxes, and spending. And these impact people, our families, our kids, our businesses. And we can do better on these issues. We really have to do better. And so I want to serve my community by bringing innovation to those issues, which will make a real difference to everyone. I want to bring my energy, my creativity, and the true sense of innovation to those issues, which will help everyone live better lives.
Thank you. Next, with those are your two candidates for Senate District 53. Now we will hear from the two candidates for House District 53A, and we'll begin with Andy Tironi.
Hi. Thanks for coming out. I'm Andy Tironi. I'm running for State House 53A. I have a couple requests tonight, and that is that you listen to a couple of specific things. Number one are some numbers. The first number is 92. The second number is 12. And the third number is 52. I'm going to try and incorporate those numbers tonight, and I'd like you to go home and listen and remember them and remember what they mean. So that's one thing I'd like you to listen for. The second thing I'd like you to listen for is the type of language we might hear tonight. I suspect we'll hear two types of language. Number one, what I like to call political speak, which is words that are sometimes kind of vague, like facilitate or collaborate or invest. and then words that I like to try and use that I call action words. And those are words like quantify and track and invest. You'll notice I said invest twice, and that's because I think in politics, there's two ways to use the word invest, the action way and the political way. Tonight, I hope to discern the difference and perhaps sway you to vote in one way or another. Thanks.
Thank you. Now with her opening statement is Joanne Ward.
Good evening. I would also like to thank the League of Women Voters for this opportunity and for all of you for joining us tonight. I'm Joanne Ward. I'm the current representative for the district, so I'm running for re-election in the House in District 53A. I've lived in Woodbury for over 47 years, since 74, and I've been an active volunteer for all of these years. I have, my husband and I have three children and six grandchildren, all in the metropolitan area. As your state representative, I've leveraged my experience in business, education, and nonprofit leadership to develop sound policy for the peoples of the district and the state. I'm familiar with both the district and the state, and have worked hard to manage those kinds of things that are important to people. We've heard from people, we listen, and we are very specific. We do actually measure things, and we hold people accountable.
Thank you. Now we'll hear opening statements of the candidates for District 53B, and we'll begin with Kelly Fenton.
Thank you. I'm Kelly Fenton, and I'm a former teacher and school administrator. I'm a wife, and I'm a mother of three. And since 2015, I've had the privilege and honor of representing you at the Capitol. I want our state to be competitive when it comes to job creation and entrepreneurial innovation. And it begins with the thriving community, both rural and urban, a strong business-first business environment, and a quality education for all. I pledge to limit government interference in your life, cut wasteful spending, improve our schools, and protect taxpayers. And additionally, I will work hard to reverse the high cost of healthcare and the Medicare crisis. I've accomplished a lot over the past 2 years, but there's more to do. And I would love to continue to work for your family and the people and priorities of Woodbury, because together we can make our state and our community an even better place to call home.
Thank you. Now with her opening statement is Alberta Gillespie.
Well, thank you. Again, I'm Alberta Gillespie, and thank you for saying it correctly. And I want to thank the League for the opportunity to be here, and thank all of you for attending and coming out to let us hear your questions and your concerns. I've lived in Minnesota for over 20 years. I lived here with my husband, Fred, and our two kids, Gabriella and Frederick. My kids are graduates of the 833 school system. My husband is a 3Mer. And I've been involved in this community for quite some time. And the reason that I'm running for office is that I believe what Paul Wellstone said. Government is about improving the lives of people. All that we do should be driven by being servant leaders and improving the lives of the people that we serve. That's why I'm running for office. That's what I want to do at the Capitol. And that's what you deserve.
Thank you. And now we will go to the first question. I received at least a half a dozen questions on Minsher, so that's going to be the first one. And it goes to Alberta Gillespie first. How can we fix Minsher, or do you have an alternate plan?
Minsher, we know, is the huge talking point right now. And I think there have been several plans that have been proposed by the governor, by Republicans, by Democrats in terms of fixing Minsher. So we have plans to fix it. The problem is that I think no one's interested in fixing Minsher at this point because it's a political talking point. Some of what's happening right now with Minsher are things that are happening from a federal standpoint that we don't have control over. And there are some things like tax credits that have been a solution that's been offered up that we could actually use. The governor said he would have a special session, and if people at the legislative level were really interested, they would have that session, come up with solutions, and fix Minsher. The problem is really that we're probably not as interested in scoring and fixing Minsher as we are in scoring political points. So,
thank you. The question now goes to Joanne Ward.
Thank you. Minsher is a marketplace for insurance, and I think the big thing that we need to be tackling is healthcare. And actually dealing with with healthcare, the whole process, the efficiencies, looking at the outcomes. We have a lot of data on how to do things better, and I think the problem really is our insurance structure rather than Minsure. Minsure is like Expedia or Travelocity. Minsure is not controlling any kind of thing, and what we're really struggling with is the independent people who are employed independently and do not have insurance through a group. We are set up for employment insurance, and that's a structure that doesn't work for everybody. So we need to address insurance separately from actual health care.
Thank you. The question now goes to Susan Kent.
Thank you. And I want to just expand on what Representative Ward just said about what Minsure is and clarify some terms because it's important. Really what we're talking about globally is the Affordable Care Act at the federal level and how it's implemented here in Minnesota. And yes, Minsure is a platform, and just like she said, like with Travelocity, you don't blame Travelocity if the airfares start going up. You understand what the drivers are for those airfares, and then you try to figure out what practical solutions are. That's where we are right now in the individual marketplace, which affects about 5% of Minnesota insured. It is a crisis for those families. We need to take care of it. I have committed to doing so. I was on the phone with constituents today for several hours on that issue. I am committed and have stated publicly that I believe we need to have a special session at our earliest possible date to have a short-term fix, but we need to continue, as the Senate DFL has done, fighting for meaningful solutions, long-term fixes to these challenges, because there are structural underlying problems that we can do. And leaving Minsure only limits our ability locally to take care of these problems and leaves us at the mercy of Congress, and I don't think anybody likes that idea.
Thank you. The question goes to Kelly Fenton.
Thank you. Minsure is a failed website that cost the state $400 million. And before the Affordable Care Act, Minnesota wasn't perfect, but we've led the country in leading health care and keeping costs low. In the immediate future, what we need to do to fix this, because right now I'm hearing from constituents every day, premiums and deductibles so high, you're basically paying to be uninsured. And people are asking themselves, do I pay my mortgage this month or do I pay for my insurance? So basically, what we need to do in the immediate future, go from the state to the federal exchange. We passed a waiver that the governor did sign for tax credits to be used off the exchange, but he's not moved forward with that, and he could. And finally, we had a safety net, the Minnesota Comprehensive Health Assessment, a high-risk pool. We could have tweaked that system to comply with the federal Affordable Care Act mandates, and that's what we need to do.
Thank you. The question now goes to Andy Taroni.
Thank you. Who remembers the numbers I gave in my opening statement? Let's get to the number 52 because I knew it would come up. 52 is a typical percentage increase that an individual can expect to pay next year if they're on the individual market plan. Think about that. We were at a forum, the six of us, in Woodbury at Eagle Valley, and I asked if there were any people who had health care on the individual market, and there were four. And one of them had their health care canceled, and the other three had their premiums skyrocket. Anybody willing to volunteer if they've got health care on the individual market in this room? That's all right. Point is the same. So the question is about what specific plans do you have? Here's an example of how you need to fix things a little bit. United Healthcare Group is the biggest insurer in the country. You know how many plans they write in Minnesota? Zero. Because you have to be a nonprofit organization to underwrite healthcare insurance in the state of Minnesota. So when you look at some of the possibilities, there's one specifically that we can do to help improve the healthcare system because it's got to change.
Thank you. The question now goes to Sharna Walgren.
Thank you. This is an issue I hear about each and every day at the doors. It's an issue in which people, often a mom, will step outside the door of their home and shut the door behind them so their kids can't hear the conversation they're having with me. And they're telling me that for the first time, they cannot afford health insurance. Their family is going uninsured. They are paying a fine, which is not going to pay for their health care It's simply a fine. We cannot keep fining people and families because they can't afford their health care. They'll tell me something like, my health care has gone up $800, and I'll think $800 more, unless I know it's now $800 more than my mortgage payment. It is truly a crisis, but it's not a crisis that just snuck up on us this week. We saw this coming. We saw this coming months ago. We saw this coming years ago. Somebody needed to stand up a long time ago and say, stop, this isn't going to work. What we need are market solutions exactly to fix healthcare costs, not to play a shell game, not to subsidize this and that, not to help some people bring down costs by asking others to pay more. We need to shrink the entire circle of healthcare costs. And we can do that in lots of ways by being more transparent.
Your time is up. I'm going to go immediately to a follow-up question on this, and it goes to you first, Sharna, so you can continue your thoughts, I guess. Do you support single payer? Why or why not?
I support a market-based approach to this, which is not a single-payer approach. What we need is competition. When you look at insurance of all other kinds, whether it's car insurance, and you get an, maybe you'll see a TV ad from Geico that'll say, give me 15 minutes and I'll save you 15%. That's what happens when you have competition. When you have good people sharing their best examples of good practices. If we had transparency, talk about Expedia. When you travel, who looks at TripAdvisor? A lot of people do, right? What do you see on TripAdvisor? You see two things. You see people talking about complaints, and then you'll have a hotelier, for example, solving those problems, bringing the best practices to light. You'll see the best places getting 5 stars and getting lots of visitors, and the other places failing. We need to showcase and share best practices with transparency so we know who has lower costs, and we go to those people so we're not collectively wasting money, and that we share best practices to actually bring the overall cost and the overall experience down so it's better and less effective and less expensive. That's what we'll do with competition.
Thank you. The question now goes to Alberter Gillespie.
Do I support single payer? The answer to that would be yes. I think it's something we need to consider in order to drive down cost. And so it's a simple yes. That's what we need to consider if we want to have health care that's affordable for all.
Thank you. The question now goes to Joanne Ward.
I would also support a single payer, at least at a base level, for insurance for everyone. And there are lots of reasons for that, but if we have a base protection for everyone, health care that will cover dental and eye protection, either glasses or whatever other people need, for other kinds of medical care, then if we can cover those things and we have a healthier community, and we work on healthy things instead of and doing prevention and helping people be healthier, we won't have as much expense in terms of remediation.
Thank you. The question now goes to Susan Kent.
Thank you. One of the things that I think has been really valuable since the Affordable Care Act was implemented was a much greater understanding of the difference between healthcare provision and healthcare finance. And people are beginning to understand better how the role of healthcare finance works for our families, for our employers, across the board. And it's a process. And so to answer the question, I don't know that we're ready to get there yet. I think we need to continue evolving this process. One of the things that we have talked about is providing some sort of public option, like expanding access to Minnesota Care, so that then you do have a different kind of competition to the private insurance companies. So I think this is an evolution, but I think we need to get there. It is going to be complex. We've seen some states try to undertake this, and so to try to do it on a state level is challenging. But I think it's something that we're going to need to keep an eye on because ultimately I do believe that's what we're going to need to do.
Thank you. The question now goes to Andy Taroni.
No, I don't support a single payer. We have one really in the VA. Does anybody know any vets in the group here? Yes. Anybody have a story about maybe a bad VA experience that one of those vets may have experienced? So I think we got to be real careful about going down that road. I think the better option is more marketplace. Let me give you an example of what I mean. Right now, Minnesota, if you look at a state-by-state comparison, Minnesota has a lot of mandates that are required if you're going to buy insurance policy, and you have to do it underwritten in the state of Minnesota. If we open up the marketplace, people talk about that a lot, but what does that mean? So for instance, the state of Nebraska doesn't have mandates that cover alcohol addiction and drug addiction, and that's fine. Maybe you don't need that specific coverage. And so if we opened up the state marketplace to allow yourself to buy something in Nebraska, the premiums would likely be lower because of the fact that there's not as many mandates. If you open up the marketplace, competition and lower prices follow. That's basically an axiom that you can't get around. And so if we look at it from that perspective, we're going to be so much better off.
Thank you. Question goes to Kelly Fenton.
Thank you. Single payer is government-run health care. And given that the state of Minnesota can not get the Minsure website to work, absolutely not. What I want for the people of Minnesota is to have low-cost, quality care with the plethora of choice. I want you to be able to keep your doctor, your surgeons, your specialist. Vermont, they tried out single payer. In 2011, they passed it. In 2014, they started to abandon it because the state couldn't continue to pay for it. The projected cost, because these bills have been at the legislature already, the projected cost in tax hikes for Minnesota is $17 billion just to get single payer off the ground. We can do better. We need to roll back to what we had before, the high-risk pool, the Minnesota Comprehensive Health Care Act. I think we do need to cover people with pre-existing conditions. We already covered kids on their parents up to the age of 26. We could tweak that program to work for Minnesotans. We can do better.
Thank you. Does anyone have any additional comments? All right. I'm going to do one quick question that came from the audience, and it's a one-word answer. Can the candidates say what party they are? We'll start with Susan.
DFL.
Sharna.
Republican.
I'm a Republican.
DFL.
Republican.
DFL.
All right, thank you. And we're going to move back to another healthcare question. We recently learned of the pharmaceutical price gouging with the EpiPen medication. The reality is that price gouging is quite normal for many medications here in this country. What are you going to do to control the rising cost of prescription drugs for the residents of Minnesota? And the question goes to Andy Taroni first.
Well, it certainly dovetails on what we just talked about. And if you look at the instances, again, I'll repeat the axiom about increased competition and spreading out options. So, I mean, everybody's seen the and heard about the situation for the EpiPen and what they did to the price in that situation. And it's, you know, if we're reaching the level of liability, I'm sure that will certainly be taken up in either a civil, probably not a criminal, but most likely a civil court. We can let that work out. But what we need to do is make sure we have the openings and the availabilities that people can choose. So I'm not specifically familiar on the logistics behind the EpiPen scenario, but if we're able to, you know, look at generic equivalents and that kind of thing, there are some options there. But it's certainly systemic of a system where we're not running at peak efficiency. And if we address that on an individual basis, it's certainly something that can be done. So the overlying message in all this is increase the competition, and the rest of the results will certainly follow.
Thank you. The question now goes to Joanne Ward.
Thank you. The EpiPen is a good example of the challenges that we face in pharmaceuticals. As I understand it, the company that manufactured that we have been getting it from has been purchased by another company. And they have taken this over and increased our costs. Now, why does the United States get to pay more, have to pay more, get charged more than other countries? Well, maybe we need some more regulation. We need some controls. People say, let's get rid of government. Let's get rid of all of these laws and these regulations. And I say, fine, if people would do the right thing, we could certainly get away from regulations. But these extreme charges for life-saving drugs beyond what their costs are, it's all about profit. And if we're talking about moral decisions, and that needs to change.
Thank you. The question now goes to Alberta Gillespie.
I agree with Representative Ward. One of the things we need to look at is how can we better regulate and how can we have there is a need for competition. I get that. But even like with healthcare costs, and we talk about prescription drug costs, it's really because it's not focused on doing what's best for people. And so we do need to have some type of regulation. When you have a company like the people who make the EpiPen who can charge that amount of money for something that is a life-saving drug, and there's nothing that we are doing about it as government, because government is again about improving the lives of people, believe it or not. The issue is that we need to hold those companies accountable. We need to be willing to do that, and we need to be willing to do that for the people in our state.
Thank you. The question goes to Sharna Walgren.
Well, there's a couple of things that we need to do. First of all, in the United States, we've kind of tied our own hands behind our back. Our federal government has done that, so we don't negotiate drug prices. They do in the rest of the world. That's just ridiculous. We need to not pay, on average, two or three times what other people around the rest of the world do for the very same drugs. That's simple negotiation, contract negotiation, and we need to be able to do that better. There is no way that people in Minnesota need to pay two or three times for exactly the same medication that our neighbors to the north in Canada pay. So we need to stop tying our hands behind our back and allow us to negotiate fair prices, equal prices with drug companies for the same drugs. If we can't do that, I'd be in favor of letting Americans buy drugs elsewhere. They're commodities. The same Tylenol is the same Tylenol. You should be able to purchase the same commodity and save your family two or three times the price. And finally, we do need competition. We do need a marketplace with transparency so that you can actually find out what various drugs cost very easily. I talk to people who tell me their same medication might cost one to five times depending on the pharmacy. You need to know that so you can go get the most effective price product.
Thank you. Question goes to Susan Kent.
A woman I know is an elementary school principal, not in our community, so I'm not outing anybody, but she has a three-year-old daughter who needs an EpiPen, and when she drove to the pharmacy to pick it up, she saw what the price was, and she had to drive away without her daughter's EpiPen, and it's unacceptable. It gets to the heart of the matter that we can talk about free market and these things, but when it comes to taking care of our kids and making these decisions, we don't have the information we need, and we don't get to follow the traditional rational man model of economic decision making. And part of the problem is that pharmaceutical companies used to say, okay, well, we're going to have higher prices, but we're doing all this investment in research and development. But because of the buying and selling of these corporations now, they're offloading the cost-driving part of their businesses, which is the research part, but they're keeping and jacking up the prices on the revenue side. So we have got to have some meaningful decisions. Unfortunately, there's little we can do, I believe, at the state level, and I appreciate that some of our federal delegation have been fighting for this. The things that we can do at the state level are potentially greater transparency and information in the process.
Thank you. Question goes to Kelly Fenton.
Thank you. And I agree with Susan, we need help at the federal level because there's limited what we could do here at the state. And I do want to talk about the EpiPen because it is my understanding that it was not the drug that was so expensive, but it was the delivery method, the actual pen itself that was very expensive. And what we need to do is we need to eliminate the monopoly that's been created by the federal government and the regulations. There were other delivery methods out there in the market that kept getting stalled because of the government monopoly. And so we do need to increase competition and open the market, and that will lower the cost. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anyone have any additional comments?
I just have one additional comment, and I agree with a lot that was said here, and I think the one thing we didn't say is that there are lobbyists who make sure that those drugs still remain at a high level, so we need to address that issue as well, because when our government is owned by lobbyists, this is why we have these types of issues. So if we don't want to talk about that, we really will never bring down the cost of drugs and some other things. Let's get the lobbyists out of government, and then that'll make it better for all the people.
Anyone else? Joanne?
Thank you. Another issue is that the pharmaceuticals companies like to have the monopoly, and they don't want the competition, and someone is not going to enter the market because it costs too much to do that when they can make a lot more having a monopoly for a particular drug that they have.
Thank you. Andy?
Yeah, one side note, kind of dovetailing off that. You talk about the factors in play and the special interests. Another example, especially in the EpiPen situation, is the crony capitalism. The CEO of the company that made the EpiPen was actually the daughter of a senator from West Virginia. So when you look at the situation, there's more than special interests. Those go not just from the public or the private side, but they come from the public as well.
Thank you. Anyone else? Susan, Sharna?
I'll add one thought to that, and that is, within business, it's common to have what are called most favored nation clauses, so that you make sure that your company or your entity is not paying more than somebody else's. It's a common way to make sure that somebody isn't getting outpriced from somebody else. Within our country, we need to make sure that we have that kind of thinking on pharmaceuticals generally. We need most favored nation concept clauses so that we are not paying more for EpiPens or anything else than others throughout the world are doing. That's a pretty basic concept that we need to employ with pharmaceuticals generally.
Anyone else? All right, we're going to move on to the next question, and it goes to Kelly Fenton first. Do you support universal background checks for gun purchases? That's including gun shows and internet sales.
Well, first of all, I support our Constitution and the Second Amendment, but I support reasonable regulations when necessary. So, for example, I supported a bill. First of all, I want to go back to there is a permit to purchase, and then or a seven-day waiting period with a background check for guns. I supported a bill that, if convicted of crime, makes you ineligible to possess a firearm and ammunition, and I voted to make it a crime in Minnesota to purchase a firearm on behalf of an ineligible person, someone who's been convicted. We do have strict laws, but we need to make sure the laws that are in place right now are enforced. And I support investing in those who enforce the law enforcement, those conducting the background, if they need more full-time, part-time employees to make sure that their work is being done, I support investing in that as well.
Thank you. Question now goes to Alberta.
I'm curious how we know if we don't do a background check if people are convicted of a crime. Isn't that what would come up in a background check? So, yes, I support a universal background check because I'm about public safety and doing whatever we can to keep the citizens of our state safe.
Thank you. Sharna? Walgren?
What I'm concerned about is preventing violent crime and preventing gun violence. And one of the things that we do is we get distracted on things that won't make a meaningful difference. It's very important to be mindful of what our goal is and whether, and when we're talking about things that won't make a meaningful difference, we have been distracted. You know, and gun violence in this country is an issue, but two-thirds of gun deaths are suicides. We need to spend a lot more time on mental health issues, a lot more focus there. We've got a bunch of gun deaths that come from accidents. We need to be more careful with the guns that we have. We also have gun violence in neighborhoods that are riddled with crime and gangs. We need to focus there as well. When it comes right down to it, the thing that probably scares you the most is terrorism. And I'll tell you this, when you have somebody who is intent on killing you, and that's their goal, and they don't care if they die in the process, these background checks aren't going to make us any safer. It's that we need to be most mindful of. And we look around the country and the world, it's not just guns, it's trucks, it's knives, it's bombs. We have to be mindful of keeping ourselves as safe as possible.
Thank you. Andy Tironi.
I'll show you something. This is my driver's license. This is my permit to carry. If we look at the question specifically was, do I support universal background checks? Now let's think about that a little bit. The guy who shot Gabby Giffords passed a background check. The guy in Aurora, Colorado passed a background check. The guy in Florida had an advanced level of background checks, two or three. And he was able to go in, and obviously we all know what happened there. So in that regard, if we want to, you know, pass something because it makes us feel good, okay. But is that really going to be what's happening? We've got the background check system that we have, people are slipping through there anyway. So there are other meaningful ways to control the gun violence problem that we have. A lot of it does center around mental health concerns, because when you look at some of the people, you know, James Holmes and those types of people, you know, there were warning signs there, and I think if we focus on that, we wouldn't be focusing so much on the means but the end.
Thank you. Joanne Ward.
Thank you. I would say I agree in supporting the Constitution. How it's interpreted is a little bit of a challenge sometimes. And public safety is the goal that we're all focused on. I will mention that I had a gun bill last year that almost got a hearing.
sorry.
I know. It really was about, it was something that the legislator or that the law enforcement wanted, and that is if you lose your gun rights because of some incident or some crime that you've committed and you lose your gun rights in, say, Washington County, you have to apply to get those back in Washington County, that people actually shop around to where so they can get a permit from another county, and a judge will allow them to do that. So that was another way to stop someone who isn't supposed to have one from having a gun.
Thank you. Susan Kent.
I actually very much agree with what Representative Fenton said on these issues. Yes, of course, we have our Second Amendment, and we need to protect that those basic rights. On the other hand, we do have background checks in place, and it has never made sense to me why we enforce those if you go to Gander Mountain or Cabela's, but if you want to go on the internet or if you want to go to a gun show somehow, they don't apply. So I do believe we need to make those consistent because we do know there are people who should not have access to firearms, and that's already been well defined in law. I'm really proud that we've been able to make some bipartisan improvements in these laws in the past few years. For example, somebody who has a judgment against them in domestic assault, they lose their right to have their firearms. And I also agree with the discussion about mental health, but that means we need to put the resources into supporting people who have mental health problems, and that starts in childhood. I'm really proud of my work with counselors and school psychologists and school social workers to have early interventions for our youngest students where it can make the biggest difference in their lives and so they can be strong and successful in the future, but it needs to go on.
Thank you. Does anyone have any additional comments?
I do. I think yes. This idea that universal background checks will stop all gun violence or that's what we're proposing is misleading, because I don't think anybody who says we need universal background checks, we're saying that that's going to stop all gun violence. But we should be committed to doing everything we can to reduce gun violence and promote public safety. And if that means passing universal background checks, that's what we should do.
Thank you. Joanne.
Thank you. The suicide issue is a huge one, and certainly mental health is a big aspect of that. What we do know from studies is that if someone is imminently proposing, threatening suicide, there can be some interventions. If there's a gun at hand, that opportunity is lost. And sometimes it's only 10 minutes. So if they have to go out and purchase a weapon, by the time they are able to do that, they are not going to be committing suicide.
Thank you. Anyone else? We are going to move on to the next question then, and it goes to Alberta first. What is your position on the Castle Doctrine, which is also the Defense of Habitation Law?
The Defense Habitation Law?
Defense of Habitation Law.
So I'm assuming it's an environmental bill when we talk about the
no.
castle?
No.
No, I don't know then, so.
I had to look it up.
Thank you.
It is basically that, I'm sure somebody in the audience could correct me, but from what I read on WikiLeaks.
Oh, Stand Your Ground.
Stand Your Ground.
Which we don't have in Minnesota, and we
correct.
Wrote it down.
So what is your position on
my
it?
My position is that Stand Your Ground is dangerous for us. So we saw how that has had some very negative effects in other states when we talk about Stand Your Ground. So I don't support Stand Your Ground. There was a sad case that we know where a person actually waited for two young teens to come into his house on a Thanksgiving, and he shot and killed them. And had we had a Stand Your Ground type of law, he would have gotten away with murder. They absolutely had no right to be in his house. They absolutely had no right to be on his property. But the fact that he laid in wait and he shot and killed those two young teens, if we had a Stand Your Ground law, those people's death would not be, their parents and their families would not have judgment for that. So that's not what we want. It hasn't helped us. It hasn't helped in other states. So, yeah.
Thank you. Susan Kent.
Thank you. I also do not support a Stand Your Ground law. I don't think we see cases here in Minnesota that it has been problematic. I agree. The case that Ms. Gillespie is talking about is
heart-wrenching, and I had the opportunity to hear Washington County Attorney Pete Orpett talk about, because he was the one who prosecuted that case. And yes, people have the right to protect their homes and themselves, but we don't need this particular law to make that change.
Thank you. Andy Taroni.
So the situation for Stand Your Ground law, and I've looked into this quite a bit. First of all, this is a lot of legal, boring stuff, but the threshold for actually being convicted if you did not have the duty to retreat is what the legal threshold now is. Basically, you have to retreat into your home as much as convenient or as possible before you can use lethal force. That threshold is actually pretty high from a legal standpoint, but if it came to actually supporting Stand Your Ground or opposing it, I would support it. But it's a little bit into the weeds when it comes to how it's actually applied. But it's, if we look at the situation where are you able to defend yourself in your home, absolutely. And whatever a reasonable threshold for that is, I'd certainly support it, regardless of what it is you call the name.
Thank you. Joanne Ward.
Thank you. I actually would just second everything that Mr. Taroni just said, that there is a reasonable judgment involved in that. But I believe the Castle Doctrine is really about in your home rather than Stand Your Ground, which is anywhere, can be applied anywhere. And, if you're threatened, if you're challenged, if you're out shopping or out to a theater in the evening and you're challenged, I think that's where the Stand Your Ground comes in, as opposed to the Castle Doctrine. They're basically the same concept, but in law, I believe it's quite defined quite differently.
Thank you. Sharna Walgren.
Thank you. There are different laws in different states and different ideas in different places, so it would depend on exactly the wording of it, because this is a really critical, critical issue that depends on exactly what we're talking about. So it's really difficult, I think, sometimes to say whether you're in favor or not in favor of something until you see exactly what it is. But in general, I'm not sure what the questioner is where they're coming from here, and that matters. But I think in general, of course, you have the right to defend yourself and your family in your home. And that's critical. But beyond that, we have to be very careful about the circumstances that we're talking about. So I'm not quite sure where beyond that the questioner is looking for. But make no mistake, when you are talking about your family's welfare and their lives in your home, you have the right to defend yourself and your children, and you shouldn't even be questioning that. Absolutely.
Thank you. Kelly Fenton.
I believe that a law-abiding citizen, trained gun owner, has the right to defend themselves and their families in their own home.
Thank you. Any additional comments? We'll move on to the next question, and it goes first to Susan Kent. We're moving on to transportation. Do you support expanding public transportation to Woodbury and within Woodbury and the East Metro? Why or why not?
Absolutely, I do. I will point immediately to an article that was written in the Star Tribune in mid-August, I believe, that talked about how many jobs are passing us by and leaving us in the East Metro because of lack of public transit and better transportation opportunities. Transportation, in all its forms, is a critical component to economic success for the individual, for a community, for a business, for our state. And we need to be investing in a 21st century transportation system that will work for all Minnesotans and for our companies and for our economic future. We are competing with other regions that are making these investments, and we are losing out, and we are losing competitively. As some have said, people don't move to Minnesota for the weather. They come for other reasons, like the quality of life and how well things work here. But we are not keeping up in this important area, and we need to make this commitment.
Thank you. Sharna Walgren.
Of course, I believe that transportation is important, and we need to make sure that we have good opportunities here. But in particular, there's probably something most people in this room are familiar with. It's the Gold Line, or the Bus Rapid Transit Project, which is specifically proposed to go from the capital of St. Paul, and now it's going to run to just behind the Target off of Valley Creek Road there. And what they're proposing to do is spend a lot of money to buy some new land and build new roads and bridges for a specific busway. The cost is estimated at more than 50 $50 million a mile, a total cost of at least $460 million to build that out, and that's not for the service and for the buses, that's simply for those additional roads and bridges to serve this particular busway. It's a fixed busway. It's not going to help people move around within Woodbury. It's going to be slower than our current express busway service for folks who might live here and want to get to St. Paul. It's an idea that simply doesn't make sense. That's the kind of silly spending that we do not need. That's the kind of spending that hurts our community and prohibits us from making other better solutions for our community.
Thank you. Andy Taroni.
Back to my numbers that I said in the opening statement. Who remembers the number 12? That's how much more, that's how many, it's 12 times more expensive to build a mile of light rail than a mile of road. So transportation is important, of course it is, but it's all a question of return on investment. Where does the line draw? Where is the most effective use of our money? So if we're looking at something, I know the question was specifically designed towards the East Metro, and the light rail transit question at hand is actually in the Southwest Metro, but it's all a question of return on investment. If you're looking at something that costs 12 times more, it's simply a waste of money. And where can we put that other, where can we put that spending otherwise? In general, I'm a fan of buses. Buses that are on roads that are already in existence. That's the most efficient way to do it, and it is the cheapest way to do it. And what are we really concerned about? What's priority? Do we want to spend our money on the nice museum, or do we want to spend our money on how we get there?
Thank you. The question now goes to Alberter Gillespie.
Yes, I support a transportation system here in the East Metro that will keep up with our needs. And I think the key is something that we're all saying, is that we want to make sure that it's a sensible solution, it's efficient, and that it's effective.
Thank you. Question now goes to Kelly Fenton.
Thank you. I support an all-encompassing transportation system. I was the chief author of the bill to do the $3 million to do the study to understand the cost effectiveness of the bus rapid transit, the Gold Line. And it had bipartisan support. I also was the chief author of the bill to do the 494-694 safety improvement, which also had bipartisan support. I believe in an all-encompassing transportation with cost-effective modes. I applaud the East Metro and the Gold Line team for doing their due diligence to find out what may be best. Right now, we don't know the true cost until the study is conducted. But these are other things we're looking at, expanding express bus service. Who else can use the roads that are being built for the bus? Public safety, the express bus. So I think that it needs to be studied, and I support all-encompassing transportation.
Thank you. Joanne Ward.
Thank you. Lots of good comments here. A mile of road is not necessarily a mile of road. If we put another lane, for instance, on 94 between here and downtown St. Paul, we also have to build a lot of new bridges. So most of those bridges were built, 10 or 12 years ago, rebuilt. And we would have to, there's no room for any more lanes. We would have to rebuild those. So a mile is not necessarily a mile. I, too, support a comprehensive transportation system and have co-authored the bills that Kelly had talked about. Sorry, Representative Fenton. There were many things that were objected to. A lot of complaints when the interstate transportation system, the interstate highway system, was proposed. Many of the same arguments that we're hearing now were the arguments that were made then against the highway system. Change is hard, but sometimes we need to figure out how to make it work.
Thank you. Any additional comments? Yes, Susan.
Thank you. Just to clarify a couple of things, when we talk about these all-encompassing or the comprehensive transportation system, a comment was made as if we do the bus rapid transit and the Gateway Corridor Gold Line, which I was also the chief author of over the past 4 years, that somehow the rest of our bus system would go away. No, absolutely not. We would still continue to have express buses, and as Representative Fenton and Ward have pointed out, those buses would get to use this line, so they would be even more efficient than they are now. It's important to keep in mind that this is a part of a bigger system.
Thank you. Alberter.
what I think is interesting and we really should pay attention to, I hear that there was bipartisan support for these bills, but yet there was no transportation bill passed. That is the problem. If there's support and we are all in agreement, why is it that they were not able to pass a transportation bill? That is my question. If we're all together and all on the same page, why did that not happen this legislative session?
Kelly.
Back to all-encompassing transportation, I want to just say that once a study is done, there still has to be municipal consent and time for the citizens to weigh in. And the county and the city, I think, has done a good job of listening to the citizens. They've already changed the path of it a little bit. But there still has to be a municipality consent, a vote from all the municipalities along the line. So please, have your voice be heard and let those who represent you at the local level government know where you stand on it.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I'd add one more. Add one more thing, and that is when we're talking about transportation, I think sometimes we forget the simplest solution, and that is road construction. I hear this so often at the door. People choose where to live and where to work based on transportation and how long it's going to take. They know all that, but they don't count on these construction projects, which really and truly impact everybody every day. And they feel a little sheepish saying, I know it's just construction. And I say, no, it really impacts our families. What we need to do is make sure that those construction projects are done as quickly as possible and that they're done in a way that they last as long as possible. That's another way to really improve our transportation within our community.
Handy.
And then real quick, I've heard all-encompassing multifaceted approach to it. And that's great, but I think we need to stress the priorities here. You know, I think we need roads and bridges first, and then if we want to look at bus transit, that's great. I think we should do it on roads that exist so it gives us more flexibility in terms of where we can go. And I think trains should be last. Light rail is inefficient, it's expensive, and it should be prioritized as such.
Thank you. Joanne.
The funding for the transit systems is totally separate from the highway funds. The roads and bridges funds. And the answer to your question, Ms. Gillespie, is politics.
Thank you, Representative Ward.
Very frankly. There was bipartisan support in the metropolitan area. It gets back to the politics of rural Minnesota versus the metro and politics, because people were going to lose their elections if they passed a transportation system that they perceive as influencing entirely the metro area, which was not true.
I'm looking at it, probably at least 10 more questions here, but unfortunately that will have to have been our last question. And we'll move on to closing statements, and we will go in the reverse order of opening statements, so we'll begin with Albert Gillespie.
Thank you again for this opportunity to speak about the things that are important to our state and our community. I'm excited about the future of the state of Minnesota, and I'm excited about representing our district. As I said, I've represented our district in a number of capacities, but I know that together, working together, we can move Minnesota forward. When Joanne talked about politics, that is one of the reasons that I'm running. We said we wanted to have pass a tax bill and a bonding bill and a transportation bill, and none of those things happened. And right now, it's not working for us. We deserve better. We gave them an opportunity to do a job. It wasn't done. So I'm asking for your support on November 8th. We can do better for the people in our community, and we deserve it.
Thank you. Now with her closing statement, Kelly Fenton.
Thank you. I'm a leader with a proven track record of pursuing common sense solutions for the community, working across the aisle to accomplish what needs to be done. I put people before party politics, and I love hearing the ideas of the constituents of Woodbury on how to improve our state government. For the past 2 years, I've championed bills with strong bipartisan support, and this balanced approach has made me the only candidate in this race to earn the endorsement of business, labor, and farmers. However, the most important endorsement to me is from you, the voters. I ask for your vote on November 8th, and I look forward to working to make sure government spending does not increase faster than your family budgets. Thank you.
Thank you. Those are your two candidates for House District 53B. Now we'll hear closing statements for the candidates for House District 53A, and we'll start with Joanne Ward.
Once again, I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters for this opportunity and to say that none of these things are going to happen unless we work together. And what we hear at the door over and over and over again is, why don't you get your jobs done? Why don't you work together? So a leader is a planter of ideas, seeds of change, and a vision of justice. A growing number of lawmakers from more than 20 states share your concerns about dysfunction in our political system. We are working passionately to plant seeds of real change. And one seed that I'm particularly proud of is that the House and Senate joint workshop will take place the first full day of session with the National Institute for Civil Discourse that I've been working with since 2013. It will be a collaborative effort, bringing lawmakers together to learn how to be respectful, engage in collaboration, and establish the seeds to grow support and meet the challenges of education, healthcare, public safety, infrastructure development, and the economy. And I ask for your support.
Thank you. Closing statement from Andy Taroni.
Thank you to the League of Women Voters for having me out. This has been a lot of fun. So how did I do? I got 12, and I got 52. I missed 92. 92 is the percent increase of our state budget since the year 2000. So when you think about that, how has your income increased since 2000? Has it increased 92%? Well, probably not. So we need to prioritize, and we need to think about what we're going to do. And if we do that, and if we make tangible measurements of how we can assess our Minnesota spending, that's where it all starts. Excuse me. Representative Ward, she won by, what, 17 and then 12 in the last two elections? So I've got my work cut out for me, but I'd appreciate your vote. And, you know, who knows what might happen. The Cubs are in the World Series. Thank you.
Thank you. Those are your two candidates for House District 53A. Now we will hear from the two candidates for Senate District 53, and we'll first hear from Sharna Walgren.
Thank you. In closing, I want to share with you a few things I learned from my dad, who recently died from ALS. Through that, I learned firsthand a lot about our healthcare system, and that's important. Perhaps more importantly, though, he taught me throughout life how to live with courage and dignity, with positivity, and with gratitude. And those are things, qualities I bring with me every day, and I think we need in public service. But most importantly, what I learned from my dad throughout his life was how to really listen to everybody, how to care about everybody, and how to try to help. And that's what I'm bringing to this, and this is why I'm running. Tonight, you had to listen to me, and I don't particularly enjoy talking to you, particularly 1 minute at a time. What I'd really like to do is listen to each one of you and hear from you your concerns, your needs, your suggestions. I'd ask you to look at my website and find my contact information. Call me, email me. I'd love to talk with each of you and hear from you, because for me, this is about serving you, about serving each one of you.
Thank you. Now with your closing statement, Susan Kent.
Thank you. And again, thank you all for being here this evening. It's been a good discussion covering probably not enough of the issues, but we've made a good start. And just a comment about dads and the Cubs. My father is a big Cubs fan, and so he's celebrating today. Again, you know, my focus in these past 4 years has been to really look at the issues that are important to the people of our community and for a strong state for our community, for a strong state for Minnesota and our community. I'm proud of the work we've done. I'm proud of my involvement, for example, in the Senate Purple Caucus, which is designed to work together, to bring people together from both parties to find the areas of agreement and try to make changes. We have made a lot of progress. Minnesota's actually doing quite well. Household income is up. Business is doing well, we're growing, but we do still have a lot of work left to do, and I am really committing to continuing to work hard for our community to do that. This is the 14th anniversary of when we lost Paul Wellstone, and his words hang in my office in the Senate, and it says, we all do better when we all do better, and that is my commitment, is to make sure that we all continue to do better. Thank you.
Thank you. The League thanks the candidates for their participation. The South Washington Cable Commission for videotaping this event, the City of Woodbury for the use of these facilities, our League volunteers, and you, the audience. for your interest and attendance. Let your voice be heard. Vote November 8th. Thank you and good night. Good evening, and welcome to this League of Women Voters Forum for the candidates in the November election for Woodbury City Council. My name is Liz Nordling, and I will be moderating this forum tonight. As a trusted volunteer organization, the League of Women Voters does not support or oppose political parties or candidates. We sponsor forums like this to provide voters an opportunity to hear candidates' views about issues of interest in the upcoming election. The order for speaking tonight will begin in alphabetical order and will be rotated randomly thereafter. Candidates' remarks are being timed to assure equality of time, and questions are being collected from the audience. Our candidates are Bill Braun, Andrea Date, Joseph Hernandez, John Jarrett, Mike Litkin, Edward Nemitz, Tom Owens, Amy Scoggins, Tim Swanson, and Mike Tiller, who was invited but is not here with us tonight. We will begin with opening statements, and we will start with Bill Braun.
Good evening. My name is Bill Braun. I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters for inviting us here and facilitating our democracy. A lot of you know me, thousands of you, when you called 911 from your home or business, and I'm the person who showed up, maybe on the worst night of your life. I earned an MBA from the Carlson School of Management at the University of Minnesota in business strategy, and the city of Woodbury runs a lot of businesses, from the athletics through the facilities and the utilities. I received a medal from the city of Woodbury for my leadership and innovation with the city, including helping to set up the Citizens Academy and working on other education issues in the classroom. Really, we have issues of budget transparency. We have an issue of a comprehensive plan where the city council doesn't follow the comprehensive plan. We have an issue where doctors call 911 with babies not breathing, and we send ambulances from other cities when we have idle Woodbury ambulances. We have water quality issues in the city. There are real issues that we need, and I appreciate your support.
Thank you. Next with her opening statement is Andrea Date.
Hi. Thank you so much to the League of Women Voters for organizing this, and thank you all for coming out tonight. My name is Andrea Date, as I said, and I lived in Woodbury since 2011. I have a husband and two children who are 5 and 2, and I've been involved in the city since I've moved here. I've on the Parks and Trails Commission, as well as the 2040 Comprehensive Planning Task Force. I have an undergraduate degree from Carleton College and a master's degree from the University of Minnesota. Both of these degrees worked extensively in policy and planning work. I spent 5.5 years with the state of Minnesota and the DNR working in policy and planning development as a planning director. Prior to that, I also worked for the city of St. Paul for 6 years. I'm extremely passionate about this city. I love it. I'm going to raise my children here, and if I'm lucky, my children are going to raise their children here. So I have very vested interest in what the development of the city looks like over the next 40-plus years.
Thank you. Next with his opening statement is Joseph Hernandez.
Hello. Excuse me. Thank you for coming out tonight. I know it's a kind of rainy, dreary night. Excuse me. Hey, my name is Joe Hernandez, and I have a website called joehernandez.com if you want to find out more information about me. And I'm sorry again for the tickle in my throat. And just like Andrea, I have children at home. I'm married and I have 5 kids. I hold a PhD in mechanical engineering. I work in Woodbury. I live in Woodbury, and I want to keep raising my kids in Woodbury. And I think that part of my policy that I will bring to the table, that I'll bring to the citizens of Woodbury, is the idea of keeping a focus on the family, keeping the family-first mentality, where we see people not as a line item, but more as a citizens of this great city that we can keep investing in. Thank you.
Thank you. Next with this opening statement is John Jarrett.
Hello. Thank you for coming out tonight. My wife, Michelle, and I have lived in Woodbury for about 25 years. We have 3 adult children, one of whom has just purchased her own home in Woodbury. It's a whole different perspective on doing the right thing for your community. I don't have an agenda. I don't have a platform. I'm not here because I have a beef with the city or I think that things need to change. I'm a business person. I have worked with municipalities and done projects all over the world, so I know how this works. I think that I can bring to the table a business person's perspective on budgeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Next with his opening statement, Mike Litkin.
Thank you, WLV. My name is Mike Litkin. I've learned from our citizens what is important. Keep the city from becoming a tax burden. Embrace diversity. I am married to a minority, so I get that. Support transportation as our businesses struggle to hire employees and buses can get them here. Vote no with Chris Burns to the $500,000 council chamber redo. Serve more citizens with that money going towards parks and open spaces, knowing that all sports fields in Woodbury are scheduled to capacity, and that is why makeup games for your children's rained-out games don't happen. Do not spend on council chamber security when we have no lightning warning system for our kids at Ojibwe Woodbury High School, which is inconsistent because we have lightning warning at Bielenberg, East Ridge, and Eagle Valley. Do know I ask tough questions. Again, efficiency for low taxes, diversity, transportation, parks, safety for our citizens first. My name is Mike Litkin.
Thank you. Next with this opening statement is Edward Nemitz.
Good evening. Thank you for inviting us here to talk to you about what we represent. My name is Edward Nemitz, and I've lived in Woodbury for 11 years and raised two children who are now adults. They went through the Woodbury school system. And I have been in the engineering management field for my entire career. I have two undergraduate degrees from the University of Minnesota and an MBA from the University of St. Thomas. I served on the Planning Commission for 6 years and was chair in my final year in 2014. And I was pleased to be able to serve the residents of Woodbury and be part of the managed growth that was occurring over those years. And I want to continue to serve the residents of Woodbury and listen to your concerns.
Thank you. Next with his opening statement, Tom Owens.
Good evening.
Tom, would you sit? It screws up the microphone if you stand.
I apologize.
Thank you. It helps our taper.
Fair enough. Mm-hmm. I'm Tom Owens. I'm a candidate for council. I do thank the League of Women Voters for sponsoring this and for you coming out this evening and allowing me to interview for this opportunity. I am not a subject matter expert. That's why God made staff. They know the details. I'm an executive. I'm the person who can look at the strategy. I'm the fellow who can look on the horizon and see opportunities that we need to seize and take advantage of. So I'm here. I did this again about 2 weeks ago with the Chamber of Commerce. And I'm hoping that when I'm done this evening, I will have demonstrated to you that I am the candidate to best fill this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you. Now with our opening statement, Amy Scoggins.
Hi, I'm Amy Scoggins, and I'm running for re-election to the Woodbury City Council. I've been part of council for the past 12 years, and I've lived in Woodbury for 16 years, along with my husband and our three kids. I graduated from the University of St. Thomas in 1993, and since that time, well, between 1993 and 2000, when I moved back to Minnesota, we chose Woodbury after living in several communities throughout the country, and have chosen to stay here for the past 16 years now because we love it so much. I've done a lot of volunteering throughout the community. I work full time as a physician recruiter. My main focus, just in general, broad terms, is to maintain the high quality of life that we've become accustomed to here in Woodbury while keeping our property tax rate among the lowest in the metropolitan area. My three priorities are going to be public safety, roads and infrastructure, and parks and trails. And I look forward to questions this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Next with this opening statement is Tim Swanson.
Good evening. My name is Tim Swanson. I am the last of 16 candidates to introduce himself to you. I moved to Woodbury when I was 24 years old, straight out of graduate school, with lots of dreams and ambition, and this has been a great place for me and my family to live. I've raised my family here, I've started my business here, and my wife Teresa and I live in Bailey's Harbor. I decided to run for city council because, in my view, it's important to have the opportunity to give back, and I feel that my skill set matches up well with being a leader on city council. Professionally, I'm the senior lending officer for Core Trust Bank here in Woodbury, so most of my clients are in the Woodbury and East Metro area. I'm very rewarded by helping their businesses grow and prosper. Lastly, I'm also a relationship builder. I volunteer extensively on a number of nonprofit and civic organizations, providing leadership. Thank you. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you. The first question was submitted to the candidates ahead of time, and we'll go first to Mike Lichten. And it is, what do you believe are the two greatest challenges the city of Woodbury will need to address over the next 5 years, and what qualifications will you bring to the office if elected to meet these challenges?
The two challenges are transportation and final build. Transportation, because we have so much retail here and jobs here that we actually need to bus workers in. We need to get employees here. Think about it. We have two targets, a Walmart, a Sam's Club, JCPenney's. We have a Costco coming, a Cabela's, etc. And secondly, a final build. Our budget right now has gone over, within 5 years, it's gone from $62 million to $82 million. It's up 30%. Our housing units here are only up 5% at the same time. We need to transition for when we stop getting, like next year, we're getting $3.3 million in developer's fees. It's one-time fees that help cover costs of things like staff, which is exploding. But when the money ends, the staffing still continues. We still have to pay them. We still have to cut the lawn, remove the snow, et cetera. What I can do for you citizens is, number one, listen and also put my data decision skills to work. Thank you.
Thank you. The question next goes to Joseph Hernandez.
Hi. Thank you for the question. And I guess it's been touched on a few times, which is the growth and development of the city. And as we near max population, max development area, how do we transition to actually make the most return on investment in those areas? And the second is, how do we maintain a high quality of life? How do we keep moving forward and providing the parks and services that we have, the infrastructure that we have, keep funding our schools at a high value? And what I bring to the table is, one, this family focus, where I see people as an opportunity. I see people as an investment. I don't see them as a line item. Two, I do have advanced degree mechanical engineering, so I'm used to, like Mike said, doing data analysis. And like Tom mentioned, I do trust my experts, so I do put a lot of faith in the staff around me. And when an expert comes in the field and says, I know this is what's true, hands a piece of paper, this is what I believe. So my open-mindedness, my forward thinking, and my ability to see through the numbers makes me qualify for this position. Thank you.
Thank you. Question now goes to Edward Nimitz.
Thank you. I think the two big issues facing the city are the managed growth that we've been seeing. We have to be able to continue that and attract high-quality jobs to the area, and also residences that want to live here and work here. And to do that, we have to work with neighboring communities and organizations to help have the infrastructure that we need and build the right types of amenities here that will attract families and also employers to the area. The other one is adapting to demographic changes. We have to make sure that we consider the aging of the population and provide facilities and services, as well as transportation for that, as well as be sure that we're able to provide the types of services that the aging population will require in the future.
Thank you. The question now goes to Bill Braun.
We have actually some real challenges, but let's identify the top two. Number one is our budget and our budget transparency. We have objectives in the budget. And when we fail to meet those objectives for the city that we've allocated money towards, what happens to those objectives? They disappear. We were at the Washington County Fair doing an extrication exhibit, and we needed to borrow tools from the Stillwater Fire Department because our tools wouldn't extricate a person. We look at the budget, and if you look in the budget this year, it shows that we're 6% above our minimum standards. But if you check with the state data says we're 30% below our minimum standard. Besides budget, we have infrastructure issues. Now, how am I qualified? In my decade working for the city, I actually had budget responsibility. I worked inside. I know the city. I actually was in the rubber meets the road service delivery aspect of this city, and I'm ready to hit the street running with concern for my wife and my five kids because we live in the community. We are customers of these same services. Thank you.
Thank you. The question now goes to Tim Swanson.
I think the two key issues relate to growth and population of this area. One is water resource management, what the city administrator calls a wildly critical issue. The demand on the aquifer here has risen significantly over the last 10 years, and with projected growth, it's going to be continued to be an issue. So I think careful planning and execution of incentive programs for commercial and residential use of water is going to be important. The other is the general field of transit and transportation. I think as the city continues to grow, employers are going to have a harder time finding employees who can get to this area to work, and that'll eventually have an issue if we aren't connected well with other parts of the city. The other part of the question is, what qualifications do I bring? And I would just say that in banking, due diligence and collaborative problem solving are very important, and those are skills that I've honed over the last 33 years in banking. I'm used to tackling difficult projects with good communication. Thanks.
Thank you. The question now goes to Amy Scoggins.
Well, I think that overall, I think we're pretty fortunate. We don't have a lot of big surprise issues that are coming to us. We've done a great job of planning, and I've been part of that process. I do think, as many others have mentioned, growth is continuing to be something that we need to take into account as we plan, you know, with our budgeting and providing amenities to our new residents without sacrificing the experience that our existing residents and some of the older parts of the city are having. I think that my biggest qualification besides my experience is just my ability to listen with an open mind. I make decisions based on what's best for the community as a whole. I have a positive attitude, and I just think that what we've done has put us in a really good position, and I'll continue that moving forward.
Thank you. The question now goes to John Jarrett.
I think that I would agree with Amy. I think that the controlled growth is number one. We have a little bit of a lopsided tax base. The fiscal disparity for especially the businesses is it's high. We need to continue to attract not just more retail, but we need to have actual businesses that have good jobs. We've had a little bit of success with that, especially with health becoming kind of a healthcare destination. We have a lot of health services in Woodbury, but we need to continue to attract additional businesses to offset the tax base. Infrastructure is important. The other part of that question, I am a business person. I create jobs. I hire people. I've done projects all over the world. I know how this works. I can look at a project and tell you if it's going to be economically viable.
Thank you. Question goes to Andrea Date.
Thank you. One of the biggest issues that I see in Woodbury over the next 5 years is development, as many of the other candidates have noted. The southern part of Woodbury in the next 5 years is going to rapidly develop, and in 20 years the city is basically going to be fully developed. I'm particularly interested in seeing how that development takes place to make sure that it's long-lasting and meets the needs of current and future residents. I'm also interested in making sure that the other parts of Woodbury aren't forgotten during this time. We need to make sure that we continuously invest and reinvest in other parts of the city, and we have a plan for what our city looks like 20 years from now. We've done a really great job of that with our 2040 or comprehensive plans throughout the time. Now we're working on our 2040 comprehensive plan. So we need to follow the plan, but we also need to be flexible and adapt along the way as things change. The second issue is transportation, which is partially a function of development. In the next 5 to 20 years, we're going to see a lot more traffic, and so we need to be very careful about the transportation to make sure that we ease congestion however possible.
Thank you. The question now goes to Tom Owens.
I see two opportunities or issues that we have to deal with. The first one has to do with our water. It's been mentioned before that our aquifer is dropping. We're told that there's a plan in place, we're monitoring it, and for today, I'll accept that. I'm the person who puts it on his calendar to check on a regular basis. The opportunity we have, though, is the express bus service coming our way. Now, Lake Elmo's washed their hands of it. God bless them, that's their decision. But the question we have to ask ourselves is, what can we do to make this really work for us? I'm told that when I'm up for re-election 4 years from now, we're going to have as many senior citizens as we have school children. They have needs. Lots of parking close to the door. Benches. Lots of benches. And they're going to need some help getting around. I know. The day's going to come when I'm in my 80s, I'm going to want a local bus service. We need to look for those opportunities.
Thank you. We'll go on to the next question, which goes to Edward Nimitz first. What is your opinion on the proposed Gold Line coming to Woodbury?
I commute to Minneapolis every day, and so I use public transit. I use the express buses, but they're inadequate for most people because they only work during rush hour and only one direction. In order to serve the job growth here in this community, we do need to have dependable transit service. I do support the Gold Line because that will be transit service throughout the day and evening, and it will be a two-way transit service on a fixed transit way, which I think is really essential to spur growth in our community, but also the neighboring communities, and also to be able to get people to the jobs who don't have access to cars, whether it's students or elderly or disabled. There are different ways that they need to be able to get to where they, their locations they have to get to throughout the day.
Thank you. The question now goes to John Jarrett.
Big number, $500 million. You know, I'd really like to make more of a comment on it, but I haven't even seen numbers on how much it's going to cost per ride. I do not understand how these projects can move forward. In business, you would look at something, say, this is the return on investment, this is how much it's going to cost per day. In transit, you have to look at what is the cost per ride. Nobody has said how much it's going to cost the person using it. I can tell you how much it's going to cost to build it. Personally, I'd like to see rail extended instead of buses. I do believe in spoken hub, but I do not believe that buses are the way to go in this particular instance. And I'd really like to see what the real cost is going to be.
Thank you. The question now goes to Bill Braun.
Well, as an actual consumer of transit services, I have five kids, and either my wife or I has to get up every morning and drive our 15-year-old to catch the MTC at the parking ride to make it to her high school in downtown St. Paul. The issue there is even the express buses are not part of a comprehensive plan. If you go to the MTC website and you put my Woodbury address in, and just about any other destination, it tells you there's no possible way to get there. That is the problem. The Gold Line is a tactic, but it has to be just a tactic as part of a larger comprehensive plan and built in isolation without our planning and without looking at the growth and development of our community, without looking at the industry that moves in, without the good jobs and how we get people and where we need to get those people to. It can actually be an albatross that stunts our future development because that's the large project that we received. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The question now goes to Tom Owens.
I mentioned before, this is probably an opportunity. I mentioned that Lake Elmo's walked away from it. That's their decision. I mentioned we have an aging population who's going to be looking for options in transportation. When we were looking to move our office in Cincinnati, we had a certain set of rules that had to be followed. And the fact of the matter is, we were dependent on having 40 clerks come to work every day. We had to be within a block of a bus stop if we were going to get that many people to show up. This is our opportunity to see how we can leverage the Gold Line to enhance our community for all of us. That's what I'm looking for and what I bring to the table.
Thank you. The question goes to Joseph Hernandez.
Thank you. And I just want to give a little caveat here. With 10 people at this table, I'm going to probably touch on lots of different things everybody else has touched on. But like Tom, I think this is an opportunity. It's an opportunity to grow. The local bus routes is an opportunity to connect the retirement communities that keep going up that help this aging community. It's a way to connect with workers who want to move into the Woodbury area. And I also feel that large construction projects also inject money, currency in the local markets, which means that Woodbury's residential areas north where that comes in may see a little bit of additional revenue coming in that stream. Let's see what else I have. And again, it's about just progress and growth, and can we be a city that connects other cities? Can we be a hub where people come into the city for entertainment, for shopping, for business, right, for pleasure? And that's kind of what Woodbury is. It's a place where people can come in and enjoy themselves. And I think that's really important to have the goal line to connect us.
Thank you. Question now goes to Andrea Date.
Thanks. As we were talking about this at the Chamber of Commerce Candidate Forum, a few people mentioned the process that has gone around creating the Gold Line proposal. There have been a lot of people involved in it, and I'm confident that they're going to come up with the best possible viable solution. It might not be ideal, but there's going to be a good solution that comes forward, and it's going to be the only politically feasible solution. In the end, we do need to see some public transportation to Woodbury. It is going to help us grow. It is what millennials are looking for. It's what businesses are looking for, and it's going to be what retirees are looking for. You know, as a public servant for much of my life, I know I might not know as much about business, but I do know that there are a lot of social benefits that come from certain investments, and there's a lot of intangible economic benefits. And I've worked in public service for a long time. I know how policy and planning development is created. So I do think we need to trust this process and see where it takes us.
Thank you. Question goes to Tim Swanson.
Now, I'm as sensitive to the cost of this project as anybody here. In underwriting loans, I have to look at cost-benefit analysis. This is one situation where I think we have to take a long-term view, and that is to say that what kind of community are we going to have in 15 to 20 years? Will we have a community that's connected to other parts of the Twin Cities via bus rapid transit, for example? And I just want to make sure that people understand that there's an opportunity and cost to not do a project as well. I would say this. I support the ongoing due diligence efforts of the Gateway Corridor Commission. And I think that the work that they are doing is exemplary. We'll find out soon enough if this is something that we can afford. And I think it's very important to continue to pursue the project.
Thank you. Question goes to Amy Scoggins.
Well, I do agree with a lot of what Tim just said. And I've been involved in the process somewhat. We've had kind of check-ins with City Council. And I've seen a lot of changes in what's come before us. The decisions so far, the information seems to mostly be driven on data and studies that they've done to try and, you know, really bring forth a good project. I'm also concerned about the cost, and there's so much detail yet to come before us. It's really difficult to say, yes, I 100% support the Gold Line, or no, I do not. I do think that transit, obviously, as we've all, I think, agreed, is very important. In the East Metro, we need it for our businesses, we need it for our residents. You know, traffic is just growing in the Twin Cities. It's not decreasing. So I definitely think we need to continue this process. There's a lot of questions still that I personally need to ask, and I'm sure others do as well. But, yeah, so sorry it's not a strong commitment either way, but that's the best I have tonight.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Mike Litkin.
What you'll notice is that I speak quickly, but if you were to talk to me, I'm actually a great listener. And I've listened to our business community on this, and what they've told me is the importance is not getting people from here in Woodbury to St. Paul. The importance is getting workers from St. Paul, high-density residential area, out here to Woodbury for their businesses. The cost is roughly $65,000 per rider right now. We need to be careful. When you create a busing program or any transportation program, it never breaks even. It doesn't make money. It always operates as a subsidy. So we need to be careful. My idea is this coming summer, let's take the school buses and run them on a simulated route from St. Paul to here in Woodbury. That gives us flexibility
to see where we need to make changes before we spend all this money. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next question goes first to Joseph Hernandez. The aquifer that Woodbury uses for its drinking water is decreasing. What would you propose to do about increasing water conservation by Woodbury citizens and businesses?
I'm actually excited for this question. It has been brought in academic journals that we are part of the threatened area because we use so much surface water. And part of that is the fact that we do a lot of yard grooming and do a lot of, superfluous water usage. So one is cutting back again on how much water we have, increasing surface ponds for collection, and looking into can we use the river sources near us as a source of water. And I guess that's it.
Thank you. Question goes to Edward Nimitz.
The problem is not just for Woodbury. It's a regional problem because the aquifer that we use actually is recharged way outside of the Twin Cities, and it takes many years for that water to actually reach us. But it also is the water that a good part of the metro area uses. So the city has to work with other parts of the region and look at an overall conservation plan that's a long-term plan to avoid overusing the water, especially for things like irrigation that could probably be done in other ways, but to just look at that as a way that we all have to work at it together to try to reduce the water usage over the long term in order to be able to make sure we have good clean water available many years from now.
Thank you. Question goes to Amy Scoggins.
This is definitely an important issue. We're very lucky in Woodbury. We do pay some of the lowest water rates in the entire metro right now, and we're lucky we get our water from the aquifer. We don't have to get it from the river. We don't have water treatment plants. It's a very inexpensive way, and sometimes I think people do take it for granted. We have several of our city staff members right now are working very diligently on different ideas. They've come before City Council with some of these ideas. The goal is to have flat water usage here in the city even as we grow. They're doing that through technology in irrigation systems, of course educational efforts, but really I believe it's either two or three of our wells. We have over a dozen wells in Woodbury. Two or three of those wells can service the entire community on a normal winter day, whereas on a hot summer day, all of those wells might be running, and it's mainly due to irrigation. So that's the biggest thing to curb the irrigation, or to curb the drawing down of the aquifer is to curb the irrigation use.
Thank you. Bill Brown.
Well, I appreciate this question because I do think it's one of our really pressing issues here in Woodbury as far as our future growth. Now, with my MBA, I've run a Minnesota utility previously, and utilities are complex, not only from their land use and resources. As we look here in Woodbury, we have wells where samples and the fluorocarbons in those samples are at 70% of the danger levels. So those wells are not a guaranteed source of long-term water as well as the aquifer use. So we should really be looking at renewable sources of water. Beyond that, our growth and our business community really depend on the availability of that water, and we need to plan for the long term. And conservation efforts help, and smart metering and all the other options that we have, but they are only one part of a larger comprehensive plan for our community.
Thank you. The question now goes to Tim Swanson.
I think some of the ideas that have been raised are very good ones. Conservation is going to be critical. The city has a plan to announce an incentive program for commercial businesses on or about January 1st of 2017. So, you know, I think that if that's successful, that can also be rolled out for residential use as well. But the real key here is conservation as a first backstop against water supply. I think what we need to do right now is make sure that we continue our careful planning efforts. I think this is one of the two top issues that I mentioned in terms of critical issues.
Thank you. Question now goes to John Jarrett.
I can't believe I'm actually going to say this, but I think that another organization or a government agency needs to be formed, much like a watershed district for water runoff. watershed districts work in unison with large areas to control runoff and slow it down for areas downstream. We can't solve the aquifer dropping if we don't work with our neighbors and with the other businesses. We have companies like 3M who are actually pumping water out to get rid of contamination. You have Bailey's Nursery, who is a very large surface user. Their business relies on a lot of water. There's other communities around us that have the exact same problems going on. So I think that we need to have a comprehensive approach to controlling the usage of the water. I also think that ponding, especially in the public use areas like Beelenburg, would be great to offset the water usage for irrigation.
Thank you. Tom Owens.
If you didn't understand the problem before, you understand it now. We've heard what the problem is. We've heard many solutions going around. There are three things at work here. The first is, if someone has an idea to help us conserve our water, let's try it. Number two, let's measure our success. Quantifiability. We need to know exactly where we're at. And third, you're going to need a leader. Someone who, when the day comes, and the day will come, is going to stand up and look at all the citizens of our community and explain that the days of just watering your lawn every other day so it is beautiful and green and lush has probably come and gone. And I have no problems having that discussion.
Thank you. Question goes to Mike Litkin.
If the aquifer were to run out tomorrow, trust me, we would find a way to get water here. So let's think in more creative terms. Also, I wanted to say that this kind of reminds me actually of when Jimmy Carter was president and we had the gas crisis. Yet look at us today. We have gasoline at near $2. So what I'm saying here is that there's opportunity. There's plenty of water around us in Lake Superior, the Mississippi River, the St. Croix River, runoff water. We have Ecolab and 3M. They are leaders in this industry of cleaning water. We have solutions around us. We can be more creative. I don't feel that we need to limit ourselves, to put ourselves in a box. One of the issues here is that we're ruled by three overlaying water districts. And so what happens is, it's like asking your mom for permission, your dad for, you got to ask your mom, your dad, and you got to ask your aunt. They all have to say yes. We can do better being creative. Thank you.
Thank you. Andrea Date.
So I just moved into a new development in Ashton Ridge, which is southeast of East Ridge High School. And I called our irrigation company to get my irrigation installed. And I was pretty surprised that none of my neighbors had had any education on what type of irrigation they should install. And there was no information or anything from the developers. I feel like this is a really serious missed opportunity and hopefully an opportunity moving forward. Part of the problem with water is there are a lot of people with their hands in it. And just to name a few, we have the MPCA, the DNR, Bowser, all of them, the watershed districts, they all have some kind of control over the water in this city. While I was at the DNR, we were working on planning from a DNR perspective with the water in Woodbury, and I could tell you that if we don't do something about it, the DNR will force us to, and I don't think we want that to happen. So we do need to be careful. Like Amy said, the major problem is irrigation. I'm excited to try some new things in my neighborhood, put in a rain garden, be creative, lead by example. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move on to the next question. It goes to Amy Scoggins first. Because of the decrease in bees, butterflies, and other pollinators, a number of communities in Washington County and Washington County itself have passed or are drafting resolutions and acting to create pollinator-safe communities. Are you in favor of Woodbury approving and implementing a pollinator-safe resolution?
Well, first of all, I don't know really what that entails exactly. I'm a fan of bees and butterflies, I can tell you that. I have milkweed in my own backyard. I have a natural area that
You know, we let it grow. It's, some people might call it weeds. I think it's great. In theory, I want to say, yeah, I would support that. I don't know what, you know, what it means to our city exactly, but I think it sounds like a really good idea. I know that these things are really important to our food source. I've read a lot of statistics about, you know, if the bees went extinct, we wouldn't be able to eat. We would have no food. So it's not really usually a local issue, but if we could do something like this, you know, and do our part to help the overall environment, I'd be really interested in taking a look at it and seeing if there's a way to implement it here in Woodbury.
Thank you. Question now goes to Bill Braun.
Well, I live in the house that my grandparents bought in 1957 in Woodbury in the first development, and I'm lucky enough to have a creek going through the backyard, which is part of the attraction of our community. I've also had the city come over and cite me that I have too much grass growing in back, and it's too wild, and you need to mow down all that and keep it mowed nice and trimmed for the neighborhood. I think we can do some things as far as smarter regulation and looking at how we enforce our regulations to facilitate bees, because bees are extraordinarily important, as well as an entire diversity of flora and fauna in our ecosystem. And a more gentle touch to how we do things, still in consideration of landowner rights, because there are people and they own this land too. So the use of pesticides, we have some issues where neighbors may be affecting other neighbors. And those are all issues that we need to take in consideration as we manage forward for a better community, cleaner, safer, and healthier.
Thank you. Mike Litkin.
The question here is a question for our farmers and our food source. We need bees for that purpose. The decrease in the bees was cited to a Monsanto GMO crops that started killing off the bees. That has been corrected. The bee population is coming back, but has not reached the population that it once was. It's important for us as a community to help the bees restore their population. I would support the resolution with a time limit, meaning that it expires in 5 years or until the bee population reaches a certain amount. When I'm thinking about making resolutions in the city, I don't like the idea of adding a complexity to the system, and that's why I say that we put a time limit on things and let it expire. If it's still a problem, it could be readdressed at that time. Hopefully this problem, like many, they cure themselves, and we kind of limit our regulations. Thank you.
Thank you. Joseph Hernandez.
Thank you. I agree that the bee deaths are an issue. It also goes back to some of the things that we do for the bees. We can help the water crisis. One that the National Research Defense Council has come up with is using longer grass. We're using wildflowers as a natural way to not only preserve water, but also have a bee habitat. Two, we can ban the use of nicotinoids, at least the pesticides and the herbicides, on city property. And we can also plant bee-friendly pollinating flowers. We can also attempt to have an apiary set up on public land that just promotes bee growth in the area. And I think, as a progressive community that needs to look at how to help out the neighboring communities, we can be that example. I think this can be brought up multiple times tonight, that Woodbury, with all of our resources, can be the shining example that pushes forward and actually sets the example for our neighbors. Thank you.
Thank you. Andrea Date.
Again, like Amy, I'm not 100% sure what the pollinator safe resolution would entail, but it certainly sounds like a good thing to me. I would want to preserve bees and butterflies as much as possible. And while I heard everyone talking, a few things just came to mind. For one, parks areas, that's a great opportunity for us to plant more native grasses and pollinator-friendly areas. The city has been exploring not mowing as much grass along the trail, which I think is ingenious because not only is it better for the environment, but it saves a lot of time and resources in mowing. So if we even continue doing that more and have even more native grasses, that's going to benefit the city and bees and butterflies. We also could explore partnering with the school districts and putting bee or butterfly gardens on the school grounds. Be a great educational tool for students. The Ojibwe Master Plan is starting.
So we can all submit our ideas on what to do there. And one of the first ideas I'm going to submit is having a bee or butterfly garden there.
Thank you. Tim Swanson.
In concept, I would support a pollinator safe resolution. I would want to know what the enforcement mechanisms are and what the time frame would be. I would also tell you that just in terms of learning about issues that I may not know a lot about, I look for resources and look to experts who can help me understand this. And I wouldn't have to go any further than my wife, who is a master gardener, and understands this issue pretty well. So the bottom line is, I think anytime that you impose a regulation or a rule, you really want to understand what you're trying to achieve and over what time frame and what are the consequences if you don't do it. So, you know, I'm in concept, absolutely yes, I'd be in favor of it. I think it's important to promote bee-friendly techniques in planting.
Thank you. Edward Nemitz.
I support any policies in the city that would create a healthy and safe environment, and including the bees and the butterflies may fall under that. Having worked on the Planning Commission, one of the things that we did when we looked at policies is the city staff would come in with a lot of reports and expert opinions that would look at not only what's required, but also any unintended consequences that might occur from that. And I would think that would be something we'd have to do and then go through public hearings so that we make sure that we listen to the residents and find what their opinions are and how this could be applied and work within their lives. And if that does work out, then we could work out a policy that would be acceptable and help promote the bees and the butterflies.
Thank you. Tom Owens.
I'm going to take a leap here. Through my website, tom-owens.com, I received a question. Tom, would you be in favor of allowing us to raise bees in our backyard? When I was younger, we had a neighbor who did that. All of us kids learned you don't go play in that yard. But you know, Tom Owens did not get stung any more than any other young man in America did. I know my parents were delighted with the flowers that they got out of their garden. The bees did their job. So if I take this leap that this ordinance we're talking about, being friendly to the bees, is going that far, every issue rises and falls on its own merits. But I don't think I would have any problem allowing people to raise some bees in their backyard.
Thank you. John Jarrett?
I don't know that I would support necessarily a resolution as much as I would support recommendations by the city regarding, butterfly gardens, planting in your yards, businesses. Certainly the city could look at planting bee-friendly, butterfly-friendly plantings in parks and so forth, but as far as a resolution, I take issue with trying to force the natural ecosystem back into something that it will do naturally. We have a huge debate going on about, you know, coyotes. We have coyotes in the city. Some people want to kill them off. Some people want to keep them. You kill the coyotes, you have a whole bunch of rabbits and squirrels and all kinds of other things. You know, the other side of that debate is if you don't control the coyotes, then you have a mess. You have them in your trash and everything else. So I would support recommendations, but not necessarily a resolution.
Thank you. I'm going to try one quick question before we get to closing statements. And if you could keep it to less than 10 seconds, it would be great. Question goes first to Tim Swanson. What was the last city council meeting you attended, and in what capacity?
I attended the budget workshop on September 14th. It was about a four-hour meeting. I included all the city council members, and I learned a lot about the budget-making process in this city.
Thank you. Tom Owens.
It was the last council meeting I attended by internet. That way I can listen at my convenience and take notes and ponder things.
Thank you. Andrea Date.
I have also watched them online. The last city-related meeting I've been to is the Parks and Natural Resource Commission meetings, which I attend monthly.
Thank you. John Jarrett.
I have not attended a City of Woodbury meeting for several years, but I did attend Fridley, which I have a business in that community, and I attended council meetings there regularly in 14 and 15.
Thank you. Mike Lichten.
I can't remember which one was, if it was the budget one, that five-hour one, or on 9/28, I spoke in person at a city council meeting on citizen safety, texting while driving. It's causing one out of every four accidents in our city.
Thank you. Bill Brown.
I've actually had the good fortune working with a utility that I've been in front of a number of city councils. My last one for Woodbury was both at the budget workshop and I attended a budget council meeting, but I too am kind of a technical geek that I watch them online.
Thank you. Joseph Hernandez.
I too watch them online. The last one I attended in person was actually in a different city in Michigan where we brought up a resolution to the city.
Thank you. Edward Nemitz.
I also watched them online, but when I was on the Planning Commission from 2009 to 2014, very often I served as a liaison for the Planning Commission and presented some of the projects before the City Council.
Thank you. And Amy Scoggins.
I was trying to think the last City Council meeting I wasn't in attendance at. A little unfair since I'm required to be there, but yeah, last Wednesday, and I'll be there tomorrow. So, thanks.
That's why I went to you last.
Yeah.
We'll now go to our closing statements, and the last shall be first, and the first last. And so, first with his closing statement is Tim Swanson.
Once again, I want to thank the League of Women Voters and all of you for being out here tonight. It's really great to see a large crowd here who are interested in this city race. I think the strengths that I bring are primarily in the area of finance and banking, having that analytical framework, having an ability to work together and collaboratively problem solve. This is something that I've done for my entire career, and experience does matter. From a leadership standpoint, I've made it a very strong point of being active in the community. I chaired the Washington County Workforce Development Board for 3 years and served on it for 6 years, and served presently on the Woodbury Community Foundation. These are important because they build relationships, and I think relationship building is a key strength of mine that would be very helpful on a city council. I know every single city council member pretty well. I've worked with them. I think it's important to be able to get along because we see what happens when that doesn't happen. Thanks very much for your attention. SwansonForCouncil.com.
Thank you. Amy Scoggins.
Thank you. Well, I feel like I'm pretty lucky in that I can say that I think Woodbury is in great shape right now, and I've been a part of that for the last 12 years. I definitely cannot take all of the credit, but we've got a really great functioning government within our city, and I will continue along that same path. We've won numerous awards. We've been recognized in national magazines as a great place to live. We've kept our property tax rate among the lowest in the metro, and we have a really high quality of life here. I really hope I can continue to serve. I enjoy it very much, and I think, I hope I'm reelected, and I look forward to one of these other people being elected as well. I think that everybody here brings a lot to the table, and I really think that Woodbury is fortunate. No matter who's elected, I think we're going to be in good hands. I hope it's me, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Tom Owens.
Thank you very much for coming out this evening. We all do appreciate that. If I did my job this evening correctly, you know that I don't even pretend to hold myself out as a subject matter expert, because I am not. I am the person, however, who can take the different pieces, see how they interact, and see what opportunities we have to take advantage of, how all the different pieces fit together. If I've done my job right, I've told you that I believe in objectively measuring performance and making decisions off of that. If I did my job right, you know that every issue rises and falls on its merits. You also know, though, that when put on the spot for an opinion, I give it. I told you, if there's bad news to deliver, I have no problems delivering it. To learn more, tom-owens.com. Thank you.
Thank you. Edward Nimitz.
Thank you for coming out tonight. And I think that one of the reasons why Woodbury has won all those awards for being a great place to live and to work and to shop is because of the great leadership that the city has had for quite a few years, very strong mayors and city council members, and a strong staff. And I believe the city has really worked to make the life or the quality of life for everybody very strong. And I want to continue that leadership, and I think I can be a strong part of that because I have worked with the city as a member of the Planning Commission. I see how the process works. I've worked with the staff and with the council, and I've been in many public hearings and listened to the residents, and I really enjoy that and want to continue to serve the city.
Thank you. Mike Litkin.
This evening, I have touched upon only a small amount of what I have learned from our citizens and what I must work toward for our citizens. Efficiency for low taxes, diversity, transportation, parks, safety for our citizens first. I believe in our mission, vision, and values that emphasize leading, thriving, and exceeding expectations. While I respect those on our city council, I will ask tough questions for you to keep spending and costs down while improving on what we already have. Again, I heard you, the citizens, say that you worry our council may be too agreeable, and I need to strongly communicate to you now that while I respect the council, I will have no trouble representing your views when they are different from the majority of the council. I embrace the work ahead as I work for you to make your experience of living here in Woodbury first rate. My name is Mike Litkin, and with your vote on November 8th, I can get to work for you.
Thank you. John Jarrett.
As I said at the beginning, I don't have an agenda. I don't think that there is anything in the city that needs to be fixed. We are an incredibly well-planned community, have been for a very long time. The current council, the current administration does a phenomenal job. I don't have any issues with our public works department. I don't have any issues with our public safety. The Planning Commission is incredible. I could only add my knowledge as a business person to that mix. Like I said, I don't have a platform. I am a business person. I can read a balance sheet. I can tell if a project is going to be economically viable or not. And let me tell you, I have done and worked with city planners, municipalities, not only in the United States, but all over. I understand diversity. I can do a good job for you, and I can make sure that our kids have a good Woodbury. Thank you. I hope you vote for me.
Thank you. Joseph Hernandez.
All right. I'm trying this one more time. Please go to joeforwoodbury.com. Earlier, I had a scratchy throat. And I think there's a theme here, which is that Woodbury has been progressing forward, and I'm here to say that I will continue that progress, to look at how we can better plan the city, how we can continue to provide the parks, the recreational sources, how we can keep a well-funded school district, how we can maintain property values, how to best use some of our zone, our B1 zoned areas if we want to do light industrial or move it over to commercial, how to best integrate the city with transportation. And so what I'm asking from you is just take a risk on someone who's been in the city for just a little bit, actually moved to the city because of what Amy said about being nationally ranked. And I want to continue that passion, continue that movement forward, and raise my family here and set roots here and actually build what I think is a nice, cultural, diverse town. So thank you.
Thank you. Andrea Date.
Thank you. Thank you all again for coming tonight and listening to all of us. I guess the big things that I have to bring to the table are a strong background in strategic planning, long-term planning, policy and planning development. Like I said, both in my education and my work experience, if elected to the council, I will be take a collaborative approach to working with others. No, we don't always agree, but we can work in a collaborative manner and get things done. We don't need to argue about things to be successful.
If elected, it'll be for the next 4 years, but I will approach it as if it were for the next 40 years. I think we really need to have forward-looking people in all places, in all public offices. So we're not just looking for the election, but we're looking for what is our community going to look like 20, 40 years from now. That's really what I'm interested in doing. My website is Andrea Date for Woodbury City Council at Weebly.com, but there are business cards out the door if you want to check out more information.
Thank you. Bill Braun.
We have an opportunity. We've all voted with our feet to move to this community, and we can always vote again to leave. Are we going to be authentic, or is it a sham? We've locked park buildings because we can't solve the crimes that are going on in the parks. We have police officers who turn off their squad car cameras before they stop someone on the side of the street. We have police officers who use code word enforcement, where they're given code words to do specific enforcement. Is this our Ferguson? We have water quality issues. Is this our Flint, Michigan? There are real issues, and I have 5 kids in our community. I care about it. That's why I'm here working for a cleaner, safer, healthier community. I'm asking for your support to help me help you build a cleaner, safer, healthier Woodbury. My name is Bill Braun.
Thank you. You've now heard 9 of the 10 candidates for Woodbury City Council, and it's for 2 positions. The League thanks the candidates for their participation, the South Washington County Cable Commission for videotaping this event, the City of Woodbury for the use of these facilities, our League volunteers, and you, the audience, for your attendance and interest. Let your voice be heard. Vote November 8th. Thank you and good night.
Thank you, Liz.
Ravine Park is actually going to have some changes in terms of entry to make that a little bit more visible, and it's all just going to look fantastic. We've got also on the list at some point is changing the bridge. You know, there's been some issues about the curve as you go across the bridge toward 3M and things like that. Well, we're working with the county, you know, on this whole project, this one and some of these others. And so it's really slated to get fixed up quite a bit.
And it is a six-legged roundabout. Right now, those kind of interchanges and intersections, as you mentioned, are controlled with just some stop signs. And so this would, we think, better keep the traffic flow moving. It would incorporate both the northbound Highway 61, the on and off ramps, and then also the East Point Douglas. And as you said, there's some new. There's also some projects there with the Ravine Regional Park, and that accessway will include some street lighting and trail as well. Just to give people a little bit of a framework for the cost of the project, we're looking at a joint project with the county, and the cost of it is about $3 million. But yet cottage gross portion is only about $1.7 million.
Right, because we're working with the county on this one, and so when people see some of those big numbers, it's not all.
And some of that will even be assessed to property owners, because there will be some benefit to the property owners, including 3M, of course, which is right down the road from that, and is, again, part of that maybe congestion in that area, but they'll benefit from that and such. And so, we want to remind people of the public hearing, and that's September 21st, and they're welcome to come out and hear more about this project at that time.
Exactly. So.
For more information about road improvement projects, please contact Community Development Director Jennifer Levitt. Thank you, Councilmember Beattie.
You're welcome.